Good morning. Welcome to the morning worship service of Harvest Presbyterian Church. I'm Doug, one of the elders here. Grant is still traveling. He's finishing up his vacation this week. So we have the privilege of having Russell McCutcheon from us. Thank you, Russell, for coming. Russell is planning a church, Reconciliation Church, in the Knightdale area of Raleigh. So we're appreciative that he could fill in for us this morning. I'd like to draw your attention to page 8. There's a couple of announcements there to include the church remains open for prayer on Wednesdays from 12 to 3. And with that, I hope that you found a way to one of the bulletins online. And with that, I'd like us to call us together to worship responsively. May God be gracious to us and bless us. Let the people praise you, O God. Let all the people praise you. May God make his face to shine upon us. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. That your way may be known on earth, your saving power among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let us continue to worship in song.
You can stand to your feet and sing, Be Thou My Vision.
Be Thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, thy presence my life. Be thou my wisdom, and thou my true word. I ever with thee, and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, I thy true Son. Thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one. Be thou my battle shield, sword for my fight. Be thou my dignity, thou my delight. Thou my soul's shelter, thou my high tower. Raise thou me heavenward, O power of my power. Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance, now and always. Thou and thou only, first in my heart. High King of heaven, my treasure thou art. High King of heaven, my victory won. May I reach heaven's joys, O bright morning sun. Heart of mine own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler of all.
Okay, this next song, All Must Be Well, It's actually one of Grant's favorites, so sad he can't be here.
Through the love of God our Savior, all may be well. Free and changeless is his favor, all is well. Precious is the blood that healed us. Perfect is the grace that sealed us. Strong the hand stretched forth to shield us. All must be well.
Though we pass through tribulation,
though we pass through tribulation, all will be well. Ours is such a full salvation, all is well. Happy still in God confiding, fruitful if in Christ abiding, steadfast through the Spirit's guiding, all must be well. We expect a bright tomorrow, all will be well. Faith can sing through days of sorrow, all is well. On our Father's love relying, Jesus every need supplying. Yes, in living or in dying, all must be well.
On our Father's.
On our Father's love relying, Jesus every need supplying. Yes, in living or in dying, all must be well.
Please be seated. Let us publicly confess our faith to one another responsively. Christian, how can you be saved? Only by faith in Jesus Christ and in his substitutory atoning death on the cross. So even though we are guilty of having disobeyed God, we are still inclined to all evil. Nevertheless, God, without any merit of our own, but only by pure grace, imputes to us the perfect righteousness of Christ when we repent and believe in him. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of your own doing. It is a gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in him. Will you please join your hearts and minds as I lead us in prayer? Let us pray. Abba, Father, your wrath is completely righteous in character and is not motivated by personal reasons or a desire for revenge. Your wrath is a holy disgust that you have against which there is contradiction of your holiness. You are holy and cannot tolerate sin. You have saved us from your wrath through the gift of your Son, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. For apart from your Son, we are all guilty before you. All who have walked on the face of this world are guilty before you because of our ungodliness and unrighteousness. We show our ungodliness when we offend you, our eternal Father. We show our unrighteousness when we sin against our fellow man. And without a new heart and a new mind, we suppress the truth in unrighteousness. You have displayed your eternal power and divine nature through your created world. You are clearly seen in this world, and we are without an excuse. We thank you for your Son, that through him and through his sacrifice, we can move from being your enemy, a subject of your wrath, to an adopted son, co-heir with Christ. Renew our hearts and our minds. We pray that we would not have a mere knowledge of your Son, but your love for us, but that the Spirit would animate our hearts and our minds to glorify you. Help us to trust and not just to know. Help us, Lord, in our belief. Help us to put off the old self with its practices and put on the new self, which is being renewed in your image. Help us put on as God's chosen one, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another. Help us to forgive each other as the Lord has forgiven us. And help us to put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. Use this worship service. Use this reading and preaching of your word. Use the meal that we'll share later to strengthen and encourage us, to seal your word in our hearts and minds, to remind us of your promises, promises that are true and will come to be. Help us to be thankful, thankful in all things. Teach us to be thankful in times of trial. And we acknowledge that we live in a fallen world. We are afflicted by broken and ill bodies, broken and ill minds, broken and ill souls. We are broken by the death and injuries of loved ones. Heal us, Lord. Heal our brother and sisters in these trials and give them strength and endurance as they ask, how long, O Lord? Give them hope, knowing that you have plans for them, plans to prosper them. Give them hope, knowing that they are yours, that you have counted them as your adopted son and daughter from the beginning of time, and will make your perfect plan come to fruition. Help us, Lord. Help us to be holy. Help us to abide in your grace and to live as your adopted son and daughter. Help us to be righteous. Help us to deal graciously with our fellow man. And we pray that we would not respond with anger nor be dismissive, but help us to live as one who has hope, hope in a Savior that has endured God's wrath for us. And give us hope, Lord. Teach us your word, that your word may not depart from our mouths. Help us to meditate on it day and night, that your word can steer our thoughts, so that we may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. For then we will make our ways prosperous and we'll have good success. Help us to be strong and courageous. Help us not to be frightened. Help us not to be dismayed. For you, the Lord our God, is with us, with me, wherever I go. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us continue to worship in song.
Yeah, you can stand to your feet. And we're going to sing, You're the Word of God the Father, the author of creation. You're the Word.
You're the Word of God the Father, from before the world began. Every star in every planet has been fashioned by your hand. All creation holds together by the power of your voice. Let the skies declare your glory. Let the land and seas rejoice. You're the author of creation. You're the Lord of every man. And your cry of love rings out across the land. Yet you left the gaze of angels, came to seek and save the lost, and exchange the joy of heaven for the anguish of a cross. With the prayer you fed the hungry, with a word you stilled the seas. Yet how silently you suffered, that the guilty may go free. You're the author of creation, you're the Lord of every man, and your cry of love rings out across the land.
With a shout, here we go.
With a shout, you rose victorious, wresting victory from the grave, and ascended into heaven, leaving captives in your wake. Now you stand before the Father, interceding for your own. From each tribe and tongue and nation, you are leading sinners home. You're the author of creation, you're the Lord of every man, and your cry of love rings out across the land.
You may be seated. Good morning to you, Harvest. It's great to be with you, not only for you all who are present with me, but those of you who are watching virtually online. Again, this is my second time here, and it is such a pleasure. I'm thankful to Reverend Grant Beachy, to the elders for welcoming me, and for you who are here. I'm always excited when I get to worship with God's people. And I'm excited because each Sunday, God grants us the opportunity to come before him in his word. And I don't take that lightly. And even though we're in the midst of a pandemic, even though we're in the midst of uncertainty, trying to figure out what will life look like, one thing is certain, one thing never changes, and that's God and his word. So because of that, we have hope. This morning, I want to share with you from God's word in Mark chapter 5, verses 1 through 13. I looked in the worship bulletin that you may have on your email, and they have the text there. So if you have that, we will read this together. Not together, I'll read it. You can read along with me, Mark chapter 5, verses 1 through 13. God's word says this. They came to the other side of the sea, to the region of the Gerasenes. As soon as he got out of the boat, a man with an unclean spirit came out of the tombs and met him. He lived in the tombs, and no one was able to restrain him anymore, not even with a chain, because he often had been bound with shackles and chains, but had torn the chains apart and smashed the shackles. No one was strong enough to subdue him. Night and day among the tombs and on the mountains, he was always crying out and cutting himself with stones. When he saw Jesus from a distance, he ran and knelt down before him, and he cried out with a loud voice, "What do you have to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you before God, don't torment me." For he had told him, "Come out of the man, you unclean spirit." "What is your name?" he asked him. "My name is Legion," he answered him, "because we are many." And he begged him earnestly not to send them out of the region. A large herd of pigs was there feeding on the hillside. The demons begged him, "Send us to the pigs so that we may enter them." So he gave them permission, and the unclean spirits came out and entered the pigs. The herd of about 2,000 rushed down the steep bank into the sea and drowned there. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Before going further, let's pray. Father, we come before you, your word. Lord, I'm in awe of your majesty and your holiness. And I'm thankful, Lord God, that you have spoken to us in your word. And so, Lord God, I pray that you would give us eyes to see and ears to hear, hearts to obey, so that we would be salt and light in this world for your glory. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. On one particular Sunday morning, as the offering tray was being passed around, the tray came to this little girl. She took the tray, set it on the floor, and stood up in the tray. And so the deacon says to this little girl, "Honey, what are you doing? Why are you standing in the tray?" She said to him, "This morning in Sunday school, I was taught that I was to offer my whole body to the Lord Jesus Christ." She understood that she was the one who belonged in the tray. The question I want to pose for each of us this morning is this: do you and I see our total being as belonging to the Lord if we are in Christ? And that if he calls us to do something, then we are called to do exactly that because he is God and we are called to obey. Or will we stay stagnant and safe in the Christian bubble we may have created for ourselves? See, I want us to think about this deeply, because what if God calls us to go somewhere and to do something that does not fit the paradigm that we have for our own lives? See, in the story before us, the whole context is Jesus telling the disciples, when you go back to chapter 4, that they were going to go to the other side of the sea. Now, we're going to deal with this in a moment, but the disciples would not have wanted to go to the other side of the sea at all, because they probably believed that they were going to encounter some hard things, some demons. They were going to a place where there were non-Jews. See, I can remember growing up, and often my mom or my grandmother, because they were the strong ones, there were men in my life as well, but they were the ones that often would tell me to do something. And as a child, they would tell me to do something, and I would, no, I don't want to do it, or just continue to try to figure out how I could get out of doing what they asked me to do. But then finally, I would say, why do I have to do it? Why, Mama? And she would just give me a simple phrase: because I said so. Now, when she said this, it was over. I knew that I could not continue to barter or try to get out of it, because if I did, then I was on pace for a new ministry called that spanking ministry. And I knew I needed to do what she asked me to do. So when it comes to God's word, we have a mandate given by Jesus in Matthew 28 to go make disciples of all nations. But why is it that often we disobey this very command given us by the Lord Jesus? See, the problem for us is that we love and we tend to hang out with people who are just like us, who look like us, who are culturally like us. But when we look at the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, he was willing and he commissioned his disciples to go to people who were different than them. You go, you make disciples, and he's commissioned us to do the same. My friends, you and I are here today because of the unbroken thread of evangelism and disciple making that goes all the way back to what we read in Scripture. In your life, someone was faithful to share the gospel with you, to walk with you as a believer, to see you go from spiritual infancy to spiritual maturity. The question is, will that thread be broken with us? Because we don't want to obey the command of the Lord Jesus Christ. Or will we be obedient to share our faith, to make disciples that will last long beyond the time that we're here on this earth, going to the ends of the earth until the end of time? As we walk through this text this morning, I want us to look at the whole context of the story. And the first thing I want us to see is this. Obedience is the mark of a disciple. Obedience is the mark of a disciple. And we're going to see this in Mark chapter 4, verses 35 to 41. The second thing I want us to see is that Jesus confronts and overcomes spiritual darkness. Jesus confronts and overcomes spiritual darkness. And we're going to see this in our base text, Mark chapter 5, verses 1 to 13. And finally, I want us to see that all of us have a place in the mission of God. All of us have a place in the mission of God. And we're going to see this in Mark chapter 5, verses 18 through 20. This morning, I want to speak from this subject, the other side. The other side. So let's jump in and let's look at our first point, that obedience is the mark of a disciple. Again, Mark chapter 4, verses 35 through 41 says this, on that day when evening had come, he told them, let's cross over to the other side of the sea. So they left the crowd and took him along since he was in the boat, and other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose and the waves were breaking over the boat so that the boat was already being swamped. He was in the stern, sleeping on the cushion. So they woke him up and said to him, teacher, don't you care that we are going to die? He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the sea, silence, be still. So the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. Then he said to them, why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith? And they were terrified and asked one another, who then is this? Even the wind and the sea obey him. Mark chapter 4, verses 33 and 34 says this, with many such parables, he spoke the word to them, and they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them without a parable, but privately to his own disciples, he explained everything. So Jesus had been teaching the crowds in parables. Once he got done, he then says to his disciples, let's go to the other side of the sea. The other side of which sea? The Sea of Galilee. Now, Jesus had been ministering. He did most of his ministry in the area called the Triangle. That's made up of Chorazin, Bethsaida, and Capernaum. This is what Jesus did, the bulk of his ministry. And on the other side of the sea was an area called the Decapolis. Now, in the Triangle, this was an area where the pious Jews hung out. Like these, the way I like to describe it, these were people who went to Harvard of their day. Like they studied the text, like they were passionate about the word of God. And when we look at the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you could find this particular theme that the gospel was for people who were considered outsiders or outcasts, like the woman who had an issue of blood. She could not go to the temple to worship because of her condition, or lepers because of their skin disease, or one particular story in the gospel, Jesus encountering a Syrophoenician woman, a Gentile. The gospel is for those on the outside, the outcast. Now, Jesus told the disciples that they were going to go to the other side of the sea. Again, this was an area called the Decapolis. In the Decapolis, there were non-Jews, and an Orthodox Jew would not have wanted to go to a place of non-Jews. See, Orthodox Jews were so aware of the differences between people that when, like, if they were going from Jerusalem to Galilee, they would have to go through Samaria, but some of them, they would not even go through Samaria because we don't want to deal with those people. So they would walk around. Jesus tells the disciples, we're going to these outcasts. We're going to where they are. And the disciples may have wondered in their minds, why would Jesus want to go to a place of non-Jews where pagans live? Now, their method of going to the other side was by boat on the sea. Now, this is where it gets interesting to me. Jews were not normally water people. Now, I know you may say, but Jesus had fishermen for disciples. He did. But contextually, when these fishermen would fish, they would not go into the middle of the sea to fish. They would stay closer to the edge, where if they needed to jump out and swim, they can get back to shore. The reason that they did not like, the Jews were not water people, goes all the way back to Genesis chapter 1, verses 2 through 3, where God's word says this: the earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the water. Jews saw big bodies of water, the deep, as the place of the abyss. It was chaos, a place that was ruled by demons. So now get the picture. Jesus says, we're going to the other side of the sea. The disciples may have thought, why are we going over a place of demons? To go see a people who are filled with demons. Why are we going to do that? Jesus, there could be a better way for us to get there. We could walk to the Decapolis if we need to. It will take longer, but we could walk. But again, Jesus says, no, we're going to the other side. Why I love this, the disciples, now in our minds, we would read into that story and think, well, the disciples may have thought this and thought that. But here was the job of a disciple. If they were going to follow a rabbi, they were going to do whatever the rabbi said. Jesus said, we're going to the other side. Now, they may have been scared, but here is what they would have done. They would have went with their rabbi, Jesus, to the other side. And this leads to the question I wanted to ask us. If we are followers of Christ, we are his disciples, but are we willing to obey what he says in his word, no matter what it is? Are we really willing? I know that we would say yes to that, but when things get difficult and hard, would we really push back on Jesus? Or when we come to his word, Do I cherry pick certain things out of his word that I'm willing to do and say I'm not willing to do that? See, I think we do it all the time. Look at how we rig our lives. We often live in an insulated Christian bubble, spending time with people who think like us, act like us, believe like we believe, live in the same community we live in. Now, it's nothing wrong with any of these things inherently. It's nothing wrong with where you live. It's nothing wrong with the people that you call your friends. It's nothing wrong with that or having same beliefs. But again, Jesus didn't call us to stay there. He didn't call us to stay stagnant. He told us to go to all nations. The Greek word for the nations is ethnic groups. He says go to all ethnic groups. But oftentimes, I think we find it very difficult to obey what he has said. It's one last point I want to make regarding Jesus in this text. Everything that Jesus did points back to the text. Like he leaves nothing up for chance. He is very strategic in everything he said and everything he did. The text says that there was a storm that arose and Jesus was asleep on a cushion on the boat. Where else has this happened in the scripture? It happened with the prophet Jonah. See, Jonah was told by God to go to Nineveh and call out against it. And Nineveh was that hated nation. Jonah hated Nineveh because of how wicked they were and how evil they were. But instead of obeying God, he went in the opposite direction from his assignment. The question is, would the disciples have picked up on this reference? See, I think sometimes when we look at the disciples, we think that they were some ignorant dudes, that they didn't know anything. But the disciples were very educated. Every Jewish kid early on would have went to what's called Jewish day school. The disciples would have known Torah. They would have known the Hebrew scriptures. They would have known about the story of Jonah and him going to sleep on a boat in a storm. But there's something else. It says that Jesus rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Does this point back to the scriptures? Yes, it does. When you have time, you can read the 107th Psalm, Psalm 107. But in Psalm 107, verse 29, it says this: "He made the storm be still and the waves of the sea were hushed. This shows that God himself was in control of the winds and the sea. Nothing that Jesus did was arbitrary. Everything that Jesus did points back to the text, and the disciples would have paid close attention to this and seen connections with this. See, if the disciples wanted to be like Jesus, they had to obey him in everything he told them to do. And the beauty of this is that Jesus knew exactly what the disciples needed. Again, Jesus had 3 years of earthly ministry with the disciples. He was strategically building into them because Jesus had called them to do something. They were going to be his witnesses to all people groups, all ethnic groups. They were going to go to the ends of the earth with this gospel. But in order for them to go, they needed to be prepared. In the same way Jesus knew what the disciples needed, he knows what you and I need. He knows what we need. That's why we obey him. In order for God to bring the best out of his children, he often brings scenarios in our lives to build strength and character. When you think about building strength and character, I'm sure they have them here in Jacksonville and all over. We have gyms, you have weight rooms, you have exercise facilities, right? And people go into these exercise facilities because you want to take care of this, the only body we've been given, right? You want to strengthen it. You want to have your cardio well as much as possible. Now, if you go to a gym and you see someone come in the gym and they got on all the right clothes, like they got on the right shirt, they got on the right pants, they got on the right shoes, they may even have a headband on and some wristbands, and you look at that person and say, they're about to do some work. Like, they're serious about what they're about to do when they come into this gym. But what if this person comes into this gym, picks up a 2.5-pound dumbbell and pumps it twice and then says, "Whew, that's enough for me. I'm tired." Then you would say, "Wait a minute. Now, you look like you were coming here to do work, but you had absolutely no intention of putting in the work that's needed for your body." My friends, many Christians look the part when they come together to gather with God's people on the Sunday. Many of us, we know how to wear the right clothes. We know how to, I grew up in a time where you didn't have smartphones, and many of you know about that. You didn't have smartphones, you didn't have anything digital. If you brought your Bible, you brought a book. Sometimes the book could be this thick, but you brought your Bible. But now we bring our Bibles on our iPads and our iPhones. But, you know, we know how to come with the things that we need. We know how to talk. We know how to sing the right songs. But if we're not careful, many of us will look the part but not really be interested in doing what God has called us to do. I believe that God understands that many of us would not voluntarily go to a spiritual gym, so he brings that gym to us. And what does God bring to us? Adverse circumstances, cross-bearing situations, difficult scenarios, and problematic encounters. All of these serve as opportunities for us to grow in our faith, going from spiritual infancy to spiritual maturity. As disciples, we are called to obey him. Secondly, I want us to see that Jesus confronts and overcomes spiritual darkness. Let's read Mark 9 through 13. Mark writes here, Jesus says, "What is your name?" He asked him. "My name is Legion," he answered him, "because we are many." And he begged him earnestly not to send them out of the region. A large herd of pigs was there feeding on the hillside. The demons begged him, "Send us to the pigs so that we may enter them." So he gave them permission, and the unclean spirits came out and entered the pigs. The herd of about 2,000 rushed down the steep bank into the sea and drowned there. Again, Jesus and his disciples, when they crossed the sea after a storm, they made it to their destination. They made it to this area Mark calls the area of the region of the Gerasenes. This was an area of the the seven or the cast out ones. Who are they? Who are the seven? Many scholars believe that these were the seven nations that were dispossessed during the time of Joshua, right? So these pagan nations are over here, and Jesus and his disciples go to this area. When they arrive, the text says in verse 2, as soon as he got out of the boat, a man with an unclean spirit came out of the tombs and met him. See, I wonder if the disciples saw this and they was thinking, again, maybe this is what I would think. Man, we just had an encounter where we thought we were going to die on the sea. And we get over here to this area and some dude with a demon comes up to us. Man, look at him. He got spit all on his beard. He's half naked. He's looking crazy. I knew it was going to happen, right? But Jesus, he's going to show them that when he confronts spiritual darkness, he is greater. And see, I think this is so important because Jesus is building into his disciples. He is about to send them, based on Acts chapter 1:8, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. They're going to encounter some of everything. But as they encounter these people, these scenarios, the disciples need to understand that Jesus is greater than the forces of evil. He's also going to show them how much he cares for every person made in the image of God. That should speak to us where we are today. Because I think oftentimes we see different people and we don't see them nor treat them as being made in the image of God. But Jesus is showing here that everyone has value. See, one of the things I think about when reading this story and looking at this man is that at one point in his life, this man had a family. This man probably had friends, maybe had a wife and kids. The text doesn't tell us. But at some point, something dramatic happened in his life. He became demon-possessed, and now he is on the fringes of society. He was seen as a threat, and he got pushed, or however he got there, but now he's living in the tombs. See, again, I think we see parallels even in our day, because in the Greco-Roman world, there was no place for him. In the Jewish world, there was no place for him. This was a man who needed to be discarded. He was treated as the other. See, we do the same things when we don't get proximate with people who are different from us. And when we don't get proximate, and with all of the information and news or just whatever it is, we believe caricatures about people, and we develop a diseased social imagination of other people that influences how we treat them. But Jesus didn't do this. Jesus got proximate with this man. Jesus was obeying God's will, and he would do something mighty in this man's life. When he encountered this man, Jesus told the demons to come out of him. Again, we must know that Jesus is not only 100% man, but he is 100% God. And when Jesus speaks, this is the same voice that would say in Genesis chapter 1, let there be light, and light showed up. And so Jesus tells the demons to come out of this man, but the demons, the text lets us know, they did not want to go into the sea, the abyss. If we look at Luke 8:31, you can see this. They're telling Jesus, don't send us back there. Don't send us into this place. So they asked Jesus to send them into the pigs. Jesus told them they had permission to go into the pigs, but what happened? The pigs then rush down the steep bank and they go into the sea, into the very abyss that they did not want to go into. Now, when Jesus did this, he put a major dent in their economy, because this is how the people made money on that side, with pigs. See, their money was affected, and this upset them. So the people go to Jesus and they ask him to leave because he was ruining the system that their world was built on. My friends, how would you respond when what you've built your life on gets interrupted? How would you respond? See, we have a system that puts people in categories. And everyone in those categories, they would do that job. But if you start messing with that system, whoever is disrupting that system must be removed. My friends, Jesus doesn't come to fit into our system. He comes to take over. And when he takes over, we must align ourselves with his kingdom. The Queen of England is a prestigious figure. When I look at news and I see her, man, she is dressed in, I don't know how much money her dresses would cost. Like, she lives in immaculate palace, in an immaculate palace. Servants are waiting on her, I'm sure, right? She looks amazing, but the problem is she looks like she is very powerful, but she has no power. She can't vote and she can't veto. Her position in her country is one of courtesy. See, what England does to the Queen, we do to the King. We give him verbal recognition. We encase him in beautiful palaces called the church. We've got people coming to pay homage to him, but when it comes to decision-making, veto power in voting, we don't need him. We acknowledge his position without giving him the credit for the power that accompanies it. My friends, do you and I acknowledge God's power over our lives? That his position is not one of courtesy. He doesn't ask us things, or he doesn't attach himself on the backside to what we have going on in our lives. When he comes in our lives, he comes to take over. Are we willing to allow him to have free reign to do what he does in our lives, in our day? May we pray what Jesus taught the disciples to pray in Matthew chapter 6. Your kingdom come, your will be done. My prayer often for my family, for myself, for where I am in Knightdale, my prayer for us as people is that God's will be done right in Knightdale. And I pray that you would pray this for Jacksonville. God, your will be done right here in Jacksonville, just as your will is done in heaven. God, break out and take over. Because we serve a good God. And when we follow him, we need to understand that where God is taking us, where he is leading, it's always for his glory and for our good. And finally, all of us have a place in the mission of God. Let's look at Mark chapter 5, verses 18 through 20. In Mark chapter 5, verse 18, it says, as he was getting into the boat, the man who had been demon-possessed begged him earnestly that he might remain with him. Jesus did not let him, but told him, go home to your own people and report to them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you. So he went out and began to proclaim in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him, and they were all amazed. When you and I believe this, that when we approach God today, we love to study his word. We want to know about this kingdom that Jesus brought to this earth, that he inaugurated. And we want to think positively about that. But when this kingdom breaks out in our day, and it's not the way that we would do things, right? It may feel more like disruption. And now I'm about to go on a sidebar here, and forgive me. I know we're in the midst of a pandemic and we're in the midst of COVID. Now, I can't speak for God, but I wonder if God is all in this, and I know he is. But it's disrupting everything that we have held dear. But is God doing something new? Is this a way that we can begin to see that his kingdom is breaking out among us? Now, I'm not talking about the disease, and that's serious, and we want to make sure that we do what we need to do to get that out of the way. We want that eradicated, but God has a perspective you and I don't. And I just wonder if God is breaking out in a way that does not fit with the paradigm that you and I may have. That's just a thought that I have. This man that Jesus encountered, he experienced in a way, in a magnificent way, God breaking out in his life. This outcast was freed from demon possession. In verse 15 of chapter 5, Mark tells us, and they came to Jesus and saw the demon-possessed man, the one who had the legion, sitting there clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. Remember, I said that everything that Jesus did, everything that he said, points back to the text. See, the reason Jonah did not want to go to Nineveh was because he knew that God was merciful, and that God, if Jonah went and preached, that there is a chance that the people of Nineveh that he hated could repent, that God would be merciful to them, the very enemies of Israel, these outsiders of Nineveh. Here was a man who was a pagan, a Gentile, who had been rescued. This man on the outside. This man whom the Jews would have probably hated. As a matter of fact, going back to Joshua, you see that they went and annihilated many of these nations, and some escaped, and they went to this area of the Decapolis. Again, Jesus was merciful to this Gentile man. What I love about God and his word is that he has always been about every people group. This goes all the way back to Genesis chapter 12, God's promise to Abraham. And I noticed in the worship guide scripture that talks about God being reaching the nations, these ethnic groups. God has always been about every nation, every people group. The disciples saw all of this. They saw everything that happened. Jesus had been walking with his disciples at the end of his life. He would have walked with and trained his disciples for 3 years. He taught the word of God to them. He explained the word of God to them. He demonstrated the word of God to them in power. And they saw this breakout in this man who had been demon possessed. Now, we don't know all that Jesus said to this man after he was delivered from the demons. But what we do know is that this man, at the moment he was delivered, he wanted to follow Jesus. The 12 disciples were Jews. Here was a non-Jew who says, I want to come with you. I want to be your disciple. I want to follow you wherever you go. But Jesus then tells him, no, you don't come with me. You go back home. This man was not trained in the text. This man did not go to seminary. But he wanted to do something. Now, because his life had been changed, Jesus sent this man back. Go home and tell your story. Just open your mouth and tell your story. All he had was the story of what God had done in his life. Maybe you're like me. Maybe you love to study the Word of God. Maybe you love to open up all of your Bible study tools, your logos, and you got your word study books and commentaries, and you have them laid out all over your desk, and you're reading, and you're cross-referencing, and you're underlining. If you're like me, you underline everything, which means we underline nothing. You just underline because we love it, right? And there's nothing wrong with that. We memorize the text. But if you don't have those tools, if you don't have access or just have things right in front of you where you can really just parse Hebrew and Greek verbs and have different commentaries, you have something. You have your story of what God has done in your life. You have the story of what he has done. And that's what this demon-possessed man had. So Jesus sent this man back. And he told his people about his encounter with Jesus. Now, there were two times that I think we have in the Gospels that Jesus was in the Decapolis. One time was when he healed this demon-possessed man. The other time was when Jesus came and fed the 4,000, which we know there were more than 4,000 people. Because of what this man shared, thousands of people came to hear Jesus teach. And they were ultimately fed by Jesus. This man obeyed and accomplished his task, Jesus said, go home and tell these folks about me. That brother, I can only imagine, went and just anybody he could see, told them about what had taken place in his life, because he was a living testimony of what happened, because people knew that he was once demon-possessed. And now he's going in with coherent thoughts. His mind is right, and he is telling people about this Jesus he encountered, so much so that thousands of people came to hear from the Lord Jesus Christ. What about you and I? Who will come to the Lord Jesus because we are faithful to open our mouths and tell people about the work of God through Jesus in our lives? Who will come? Yes, I do understand that it is the Spirit of God that needs to move on the hearts of people, and God does the drawing, but he uses us. He uses us. We're his instruments. We're his witnesses. And so we go out and we share with people of who the Lord Jesus is. Will we obey the command of Jesus to make disciples of all nations? My friends, there are so many people around us who need to hear. I don't live in Jacksonville, but I know there are thousands upon thousands of people here who need to hear the gospel. Even with churches being all around, there are still people who need to hear. Will you offer yourself as one used by God to go and proclaim his excellencies in a way that pleases him? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. We praise you for your work, even among those who are considered outcasts. And the truth of the matter is this. At one point, Lord God, we were outcasts. We were on the fringes. As Ephesians 2 would say, we were dead in our trespasses and sins, but you made us alive, Lord. If we look back on it, I can think back personally on my life. I just remember I'm looking at the man's face who one day early wanted to talk about Jesus with me. And from that time, about 20 years ago, 21 years ago, Lord God, I reflect back and realize that I am now your son. Lord, may we be people who open our mouths to proclaim the good news of the gospel and trust you by your Spirit that you would bring people to yourself. We ask this in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Now is the time where we want to turn our attention to the family meal, the covenant meal. And as we prepare for that, I want to say this. If you're here this morning and you're not in the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm going to ask that you refrain from taking the elements. But I will say this. I trust that the Spirit of God will be at work in your heart. As an old theologian I heard a long time ago, J. Vernon McGee, he says the hound of heaven, it's like he will sniff you out. If the Spirit is messing with you, there are leaders here, there are elders here, and if you want to know more about what it means to trust Jesus, please speak with them, because we don't want this meal, we don't ever want you not to partake of this meal. We want you to partake of it. But right now, if you're not in Christ, we ask that you refrain from it. But for those of you who are in Christ, there are four stations where there we have prepackaged elements. And we're asking that you would send one person from your family, if you haven't already, to get your elements, come back to your seats, disperse the elements among your people, and hold those elements, because we're going to take all of those things together. So now I would ask at this time that you would go and grab the elements so that we can partake. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said to them, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." Then he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them and said this, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." So, my friends, for his body broken, let us eat together. And for his blood poured out for us, let us drink together. Got it. And I'll come back and do the benediction.
All right, our closing song is "It's Not Long Till the Day of the Lord." You can please stand up, and we'll sing it expectantly, looking forward, and proclaiming that our hope is in Christ and the faith that we have.
It's not long till the boastful are silenced and shamed. It's not long till the wealth of the wicked's reclaimed. And the ones who have waited with eyes on the Lord will shine like the sun forevermore. It's not long till the day of the Lord.
Just be still and be faithful.
Just be still and be faithful and dwell in the land. Put your trust in the Savior and cling to his hand. When your heart burns with anger for all that is wrong, do not let the dark steal your song. It's not long till the day of the Lord. It's not long till the day of the Lord. It's not long till the day of the Lord. Everything that is broken will soon be restored. It's not long till the day of the Lord.
Do not fear.
Do not fear for the wicked with weapons of war. For the Lord is the shelter and strength of the poor. And our God comes with laughter. Let him be your joy. The power of the sword he'll destroy. It's not long till the day of the Lord. It's not long till the day of the Lord. It's not long till the day of the Lord. Everything that is broken will soon be restored. It's not long till the day of the Lord.
Just your voices.
It's not long till the day of the Lord. It's not long till the day of the Lord. Everything that is broken will soon be restored. It's not long till the day of the Lord.
Receive this benediction from Numbers 6, 24 through 26. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. You're dismissed.